Hi there, Doug Stimmel with IT Creations with the 2U HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen11 server. This is definitely one of HPE's workhorse servers that can be configured for just about any applications you have in mind. Of course, this is also accelerator optimized to support single wide or double wide GPUs and features fourth or fifth generation AMD EPYC processors with up to 160 physical cores per socket. I mean, everything has to have AI capabilities at this point, right? If you like our channel, hit that subscribe button. If you're still on the fence, then let's get to it. This is a do-everything platform, depending on how it's configured. Today, we'll also take a little visit to Italy with AMD's EPYC line of processor codenames. We've already seen the sights of Naples, Rome, Milan with the first, second, and third generation CPUs. With the fourth generation, we'll take a look at Genoa, the setting for Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew, and then Turin, Italy with fifth generation. Shakespeare never did a play based on Turin, but Alfa Romeo based there. There's no relation. Anyways, as you may have already guessed, with support for GPU accelerators, this platform is good for a number of AI workloads, machine learning, big data analytics, inference, that kind of thing. Oh, also high-performance computing applications, which is pretty vague, but think about it as a catch-all box where you can basically throw in every other workload. There is the option to install one of HPE's cool-looking security bezels. Kind of looks like a first-shooter game target. Behind that, there are several different hybrid storage configurations. First, a few with 2.5-inch drive bays. The 24-bay option for SAS, SATA, or U.3 NVMe drives. That first storage cage in Box 1 has a default configuration with U.3 NVMe drives. Box 1 can also be outfitted with a universal media bay that supports two 2.5-inch drive bays, plus an optional optical device and a few USB ports. In that case, you'll have 16 2.5-inch drive bays plus the additional two on the universal media bay for 18 total on the front of the system. The GPU configuration has storage only in the central storage cage with the option for 8 SFF U.3 or up to 8 E.3 EDSFF bays. But that's not all. We'll get to the rest of the storage options in just a minute. In the meantime, are you interested in the HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen 11 server? If you are, then for a limited time, you can save up to $500 off a system that's listed or one that you can configure at IT Creations that's valued at $5,000 or more. Just click that link to find out more about this exciting system. When you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video. Now, where was I? There's also a 24-bay E3.S EDSFF option with drive boxes 1 and 3 taken up with 12 drive bays each. Then another with support for 36 EDSFF drives. That loads up the drive boxes 1, 2, and 3. Then an option for an 8-bay chassis with 3.5-inch drive bays with another option for 2 SF bays and an optical drive on top. Instead of the three potential drive cages aligned vertically on the 2.5-inch chassis, the three drive cages are aligned horizontally on the 3.5-inch chassis. Oh, and of course, there is another basic configuration with 12 3.5-inch storage bays on the front of the chassis. I may have missed something, but in a nutshell, there are a bunch of configure-to-order options to start configuring your ultimate server and ranging from storage to GPU support. I will mention with a CTO GPU option, you can only install 8 drives maximum. We haven't even looked at the back of the system, nor the option for internal mid-tray storage options, which I'll get to right now. With the 2.5-inch 24-bay chassis, there is also an optional mid-tray that can be outfitted with 24 more 2.5-inch drives in a tilt-up drive carriage for 48 2.5-inch drive bays total. The mid-tray is also with three boxes starting left to right, boxes 4, 5, and 6. Another mid-tray design offers 8 2.5-inch drive bays. And still another mid-tray with 4 3.5-inch drive bays, that on top of the 12 or 8 up front 3.5-inch drive bays. Next, options for the rear, either two 2.5-inch drive bays over the rear PSUs that will occupy the tertiary riser, or four 3.5-inch drive bays that take up the entire top of the chassis and back, plus knocking out a few PCI slots on the primary, secondary, and tertiary risers. Let's finish up the front and the back of the system. The control panel has the power on button, health LED, NIC status LED, and unit ID button. Then an ILO service port and USB 3.2 Gen 1 port. Around the back of the platform, what you see will really depend on the configuration. On the far right-hand side above the PSU, there is space for an optional M.2 boot device that can be outfitted with one or two M.2 storage devices. The two drives can be configured in a hardware RAID 1 for resiliency. This particular system is outfitted with 800 watt dual redundant PSUs, but there are quite a few PSUs to choose from, including an 800 watt to 2200 watt option. Adjacent to the PSUs is a VGA connector, then OCP mezzanine card slot with another on the far left. Between those, a small I/O panel with two USB 3.2 Gen 1 slots, an RJ45 port providing dedicated LAN port for the embedded integrated lights out management utility, then an optional serial port. Above, starting on the left, PCI slots for the primary, secondary, and tertiary risers. Again, if you decide to go with additional rear storage options, you will lose some of those PCI slots. That dedicated ILO LAN port on the back of the system provides remote access to the system to configure, monitor, and update. With the Gen 11 servers, HPE has updated their integrated lights out software from ILO 5 to ILO 6. ILO 6 standard is embedded and comes with intelligent provisioning. One thing I will mention is no remote access unless you have ILO Advanced, which activates the integrated remote console. ILO is a one-to-one management utility and suitable for managing this system independently. To manage the whole infrastructure, including servers, storage, and networking hardware, there's HPE OneView. Again, you can download the standard version, but if you want remote, unified management, you will need to install the licensed OneView Advanced or Advanced Premium Security Edition, plus ILO 6 Advanced. OneView also allows for integration with third-party management and monitoring tools. What HPE is saying, and many other manufacturers as well, is basically that AMD is kicking Intel's proverbial butt in the high-end CPU category. In a nutshell, more cores, more cache, and more memory supported because more memory channels. Oh, and more PCI lanes too. If you compare 5th gen AMD EPYC CPUs to 5th gen Intel Xeon Scalable processors, there's not really much of a comparison. On core counts, 5th gen AMD EPYCs are at up to 192 cores compared to a top-end 5th gen Xeon at up to 64 cores, maximum. Perhaps with Intel Xeon 6 processors, parity will be somewhat re-established, but that remains to be seen. There's always AMD's next CPU release. I can't wait to see that one. Both 4th and 5th generation AMD EPYC processors feature 12-channel memory architecture. Intel has 8-channel memory architecture, but enough of that. With each processor in charge of 12 DDR5 memory module slots, there are 24 memory module slots total for one DIMM per channel. I will mention that each CPU is capable of supporting up to 6 terabytes of memory, but that would be with 24 memory module slots per socket. Since we all have the 12 memory module slots per socket, the system is capped at 6 terabytes of memory. Memory speed is dependent on the CPU, with 4th gen offering speeds of up to 4800 megatransfers per second, while 5th gen CPUs can provide speeds of up to 5600 megatransfers per second. This platform is set up with two 32-core AMD EPYC 9384X processors. Those are the 4th generation processors, and the X suffix indicates this is one of three different SKUs that offer AMD's 3D V-Cache technology with a larger L3 cache at 768 megabytes. It has a default thermal design power rating of 320 watts and can be used in single or dual processor configurations. With that large L3 cache, these CPUs offer improved data access speeds with more data able to queue right at the CPU. Initially, these processors were targeted at other more esoteric applications like quantum mechanics, fluid dynamics, and weather forecasting. Perhaps people were a little confused by that. AMD has since described these CPUs for technical computing or technical computing workloads. Moving on. CPUs with up to 160 physical cores each can be installed for up to 320 physical cores and 640 virtual threads with both CPUs installed. Those would be the top-of-the-line CPUs supported on this platform, specifically the AMD EPYC 9845. Looks like the thermal design power range is capped at up to 400 watts, since the only processor not listed is the 500-watt TDP AMD EPYC 9965 with 192 physical cores and 384 virtual threads. With higher wattage CPUs, you will need some performance heat sinks and the maximum performance fan kit. There's also an option for direct liquid cooling, depending on the configuration. This system is outfitted with 24 32-gigabyte DDR5 registered DIMM modules for up to 768 gigabytes of memory. Each of the CPUs also delivers 160 PCI 5.0 lanes for 320 PCI 5.0 lanes total. Really helpful for supporting all of those Gen 5 EDSFF drives and GPUs. There are a bunch of configurations for the expansion slots supported in the primary, secondary, and tertiary risers. Without additional drives in back, the system can support up to 8 PCI slots in total. That doesn't include the two OCP card slots for additional network connectivity, which you will definitely need if you decide to go with the 8 single-wide GPU option. probably the 4 GPU option as well, given the double-wide form factor will obscure some of those PCI slots. You will need a hard drive controller if you would like to implement RAID or just have more control over your storage, as one thing EPYCs don't have is an integrated HD controller. The OCP mezzanine card slots can also be used to support a hard drive controller. By default, the OCP card slots are by 8, but they can be upgraded to a by 16 link width via an optional OCP upgrade cable kit. A ton of restrictions associated with that, along with every other option on this platform. If I talked about all of those restrictions, we would be here for a long time. Well, actually probably just me, while all of you went to sleep one by one. There are several GPU options, including the NVIDIA H100 NVL with 94 gigabytes of HBM3 memory with a PCIe 5.0 by 16 interface. That one specifically is one of the go-to cards for AI applications like conversational AI and large language models. Also quite expensive. If you don't need that kind of performance, good alternatives are the L40 and L40S, each with 48 gigabytes of GDDR6 memory. Those last two cards also excel at 3D graphics and rendering. Quite sure some of these Blackwell GPUs can also be installed in this system. HP just hasn't tested them. You could also use those PCI slots for faster network controllers with InfiniBand options up to 200 gigabits per second. A number of different storage controllers and HBAs can also be installed. It all depends on what you need for whatever workload you're trying to address. Cores aren't everything and neither are GPUs if you don't need them. You still awake? I do hope you enjoyed this rather long-winded overview of the HPE ProLiant DL385 Gen11 server. There was quite a bit to go over given the multitude of possible configurations. If you have any comments or questions, post them in the comment section below. Subscribe if you want to see more server or workstation reviews. And if you want more information on this server, I placed a few links in the description section, or you can hit that one right there. ITCreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Stewart with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.